Hello and welcome to my talk on navigating the ARM bootstrap matryoshka. My name is Ahmad Fatoun. I am an embedded software engineer with Pingotronics, a German Linux consulting company, where I have been involved in a number of projects around ARM SoCs and had the chance to use and develop parts of bootchains on ARM SoCs. One of these ARM SoCs is the NXP IMX8MM, which is a multi-core ARM Cortex-A53, it's the same like on the Raspberry Pi 3, and it also can have has a Cortex-M4 as co-processor. It's one of the first 64-bit ARM SoCs and implements the first specification for them, which is ARM version 8.0a. We are picking one specific SoC for this talk, because this early bootstrap stuff is very different from SoC to SoC. The main, the basic flow is the same, but how it's actually implemented differs considerably, so we best stick to one of them. And we stuck here to the IMX8MM because the IMX series has comparatively open documentation and good open source software support due to that. And it's also used in some open source, in some projects that have their focus on open source software use, like the MNT Reform laptop, which uses an 8NQ, and the Purist Limbrim 5, which uses an 8MM, like the one we will talk about here. So how does the boot start on an IMX8MM? It's not much different than on any other SoC at the very first. Normally, you have a program that executes another program, and that program is executed by another program, but the first program needs to start from somewhere. And this somewhere is called the reset vector. Vector is an older term for a pointer. So where does this reset vector point at? The implementation, which is NXP in this case, which integrates the ARM SoC, decides on an address. And at that address, there must be some memory chip that you can execute off from. This could be an on-chip SRAM. But the problem with such a RAM is that someone needs to preload it, because when it comes out of reset, it doesn't have actual code in it that you can execute. This works when you don't bootstrap the first CPU. So your primary CPU has started, and then you want to bootstrap your second CPU. So the first CPU could load code for a second CPU to execute into RAM. So that works. But for the first CPU, we need something else. Another way is to have memory mapped flash. So that's flash that looks like memory and can be connected just like memory, or it has a controller that make it appear to the CPU as if it were something that's memory mapped. And you can just read off it and execute off it. The problem with that is that you have an extra flash chip that you need to program, and that extra flash chip that is accessible over that way is usually not the same storage that you use for the rest of the system, because it's usually slower or more expensive. And there is a security hazard as well, because anyone who can get his hands on the hardware could desolder the chip, replace it with his own, and then they own the system, basically. So what is now the norm on any modern SoC is a mask boot ROM that you can disable. So you have fused into the chip a ROM, and that ROM starts as soon as you start off your power on reset. This saves effort, because you can have software on your boot ROM that, for example, over USB allows you to program the rest of your system. And it saves cost, because you can then boot off a SATA SSD, or boot off flash, or an MMC SD card, and so on. So you don't need more than that one chip that you use for your boot chain and for your actual system. And if you trust the crypto implementation of the vendor of your SoC, you can use it to verify your bootloader and start a trusted boot chain that way. So you can use it as a building block to ensure no one else can flash unsigned software on your system. Let's say these are the generic considerations. The boot ROM in the IMX8M behaves like this. So what does it actually do? At the start, it needs to configure the PLLs and the clocks. So you've got these two clock inputs, for example, a slow clock at 32 kilohertz or so, and a clock at 20 megahertz. And then you need to get all these different frequencies that you need for the different IP blocks in your system. So you have USB, you have an SD card, you have peripherals inside that need to be clocked, you have a memory controller, and so on. All these need different clocks with different frequencies. And so you need to configure these PLLs at the start with their frequencies, and then you have a tree of dividers and so on to reach all these frequencies you need. And the boot ROM does that for the hardware that it needs to use. It also needs to do some more initialization for the hardware. For example, you have an array of SRAMs for different things, and you need to configure the latencies, because at start the CPU doesn't know about these different parts that are on the system on chip. What it also does on CPU level is set up a stack for execution and an initial interrupt vector table. When this basic setup is done, it will need to think about actually bootstrapping the system. This works by taking some configuration from the user and then deciding on where to boot from. During development, this configuration comes from the strapping pins. You see here an example that's a DIP switch on an evaluation kit, and you can encode in these DIP switches, you see that to the upper left, a sequence that tells the SoC's boot ROM to, okay, please start off the download mode for recovery, or start from SD card 1 or from the eMMC in the second slot, and so on. This is very nice for development. If you don't have a DIP switch, you can also do it directly by wiring pull-ups and pull-downs on your board. But for actual use, you will want to persist this configuration, but you can't do that via strapping pins. You can just desolder them. And you can change the code, because that's ROM, that's read-only memory. You have no access to that. But what you can do is that you have these electronically blowable fuses inside of the SoC that you can blow. And when you blow that fuse, for example, that means boot from that mechanism. When you blow that fuse, that means disable recovery boot or enable the watchdog. So now the SoC knows what to look at to boot the system. And, well, it has a list of stuff to try, and then it does that in order. And it can be quite extensive, all these different boot medias and mechanisms that a boot ROM can use. Here is my favorite example, which is a Texas Instruments SoC, and I have marked some points, RNDIS, BootP, and TFTP. So how they interact with each other is that basically the SoC sets up a USB gadget. It does via RNDIS Ethernet over USB on top of that. It runs a DHCP client on top of that. It gets an IP address and then uses the UDP-based TFTP protocol to actually fetch something over the network. And all that is really wired hard into the chip, which I find quite impressive for software you can change. And software, like everything else that's complex, has bugs. And boot ROMs are no exception to that. So sometimes workarounds are possible. Here is an example where the boot ROM configures the clock tree in a way that a divider is out of spec, and this leads to an unstable system. Okay, if you come early enough in the bootloader, you can fix that before a problem happens. And if a problem happens, you have your watchdog. But sometimes this is not possible, which is, for example, this vulnerability, which was a buffer overflow during signature checking in older IMX boot ROMs. And so only fix for that is to get new hardware, which is unfortunate. So back to our new IMX8M. So now it knows where to boot from, for example, of an SD card. And the first thing it looks for is that at a specific offset, it expects a header. For the IMX, this header is called an image vector table. so vector pointer, so it's a series or a table of pointers. One pointer is to device configuration data, more on that on the next slide. One more is for the bootloader binary, which we actually want to load as our next stage. The load address, where should it be copied? And a command sequence file, which includes our signature, which is needed for a trusted boot. And NXP signed HDMI 5 firmware. So one thing is not like the others. Why do you have to worry about HDMI during very, very early boot? And the thing is, you have NXP. NXP has its customers, and it wants to give them the ability to certify for streaming, for example, a high-definition Netflix video. And how do you do that? By encrypting the content that goes over the HDMI link. But if you just allow anyone to flash software on the HDMI file, they could siphon out the keys. So they say, okay, only our software can be flashed, and that's ensured by the signature. And the boot ROM does the check of the signature, and it turns off the JTAG during the check and turns it off on, so you can't use a hardware debugger to influence it. And well, and that's the reason you need to do that very early on. In the boot ROM context, the loading of the firmware. And yeah, you can also set a flag whether your boot image is a plugin. More on that on the slide after that. So, IMX device configuration data. This is an IMX specific feature, which is basically having bytecode that's executed by a virtual machine implemented in the boot ROM. This runs before your actual ARM code runs, and it can do memory accesses. It can write 8 or 16 or 32-bit literals. It can poll until a bitwise end operation is true, and it can set and clear bits via a mask you specify. This doesn't sound like much, but if you have written some low-level driver before, you can imagine this be enough for a lot of things, and indeed it's enough to set up a DDR3 memory controller like found on the IMX6. But it's not enough for our IMX8M here with its low power DDR4 memory, because it's not flexible enough to configure the voltages via I2C. You don't have any flow control, so you don't have an if statement or something like that. And it's not flexible enough because no flow control that you can properly set up a DDR4 with it. We also mentioned plugin images, which are for running ARM codes when the DCD table isn't expressive enough. And the difference between just running normal ARM code is that it returns back to the boot ROM, so you don't need to do your own authentication in your early boot ARM code. But it still doesn't help you to not re-implement access to the boot media. So the boot ROM has the software routines for reading of a wide array of stuff, like we have seen TFTP, but also normal stuff like reading of an eMMC boot partition. You will need to re-implement this stuff. And it would be nice to give that, to have the boot ROM do that for you as well for the next stage. But this is not possible with the IMX8MM. But I have learned that it's possible with the 8M Plus and Nano, which are the newer ones in the series. So I am interested in seeing how that works out, but I have no personal experience with that. Regardless, it's not used in Barebox, so we will have to, out of the ARM code, to have a driver for the boot media to continue boot. So what now? You now know enough to bootstrap a Hello World over serial application. And now you want to bootstrap Linux. So what else is there? What else can you possibly need? So Linux has documentation on how to boot on ARM64. And there are some optional parts, there are some mandatory parts. And I have collected here the most important parts for us. Set up and initialize RAM. So far we have only access to on-chip SRAM, but the external DRAM, which is quite bigger, the on-chip SRAM is in the ballpark of a few hundreds kilobytes at most, while the off-chip DRAM can be up to gigabytes in size, and you will probably want your Linux to have more memory available than 256 kilobytes is the size of the SRAM, the main SRAM on the IMX8MM, I think. So you need to set that up. You need to install a secure monitor for CPU power management, more on that later. You need to set up hardware description in the form of a device tree, so Linux knows what board it runs on and what peripherals are there. And then you need to jump to the kernel image and hand over control, basically. So what does it mean to set up and initialize the RAM? One thing is that you set up the voltages. So you have these voltage regulators and these rails, which need defined voltages for CPUs, for DRAM, and so on, for these operating points and frequencies that they, which are these frequencies that they can operate at. Sometimes these voltages just are the correct ones out of the box because you can strap or fuse into the chip how it should be configured. And some more times these are general purpose parts that you need to configure explicitly via I2C. For our purposes, this means we need an I2C driver in our early boot code. You then need to configure the DRAM controller in your SoC so it can properly talk to the hardware. This is a function of looking at the datasheet of the device and taking some key values out of it, and the routing that you have actually on board to the device, and the DRAM controller that you have, and even the environment, like the temperature that you have, and so on. So you have from the vendor Windows software that flashes you a binary onto the board, into memory, and then out of SRAM does some testing and so on, gives you some values back. You have an Excel sheet that you put it in, and that generates code for you. And that code communicates with a firmware blob that you load into a PHY on the DDR controller, and that does the training so you can actually use your DDR4 RAM. Sounds complicated, but it works. These Excel sheets used to generate actual DCD commands, so you could just step over the SRAM, not use it at all in early boot, and go directly into DRAM. That was the case with the IMX6, but for the IMX8, because you have your I2C stuff you need to do, and because you actually have a coprocessor on the and a remote microcontroller on the DDR controller, so you need to communicate with it, and you need to write actual ARM code. And that ARM code runs out of SRAM. So SRAM, as we said, is limited in size. You can't just load your whole bootloader into the SRAM. So you need some first stage bootloader that loads your main bootloader, or even loads the kernel, if you fancy so. So that's called in U-boot parlance the secondary program loader. It's also called a first stage bootloader, assuming the boot ROM is a zeros stage. So this SPL runs from SRAM, or maybe it's executed in place if the memory supports that. And its purpose is to set up the DRAM, as we said. For Barebox, this is called the pre-bootloader. Its function is normally to extract Barebox to the end of RAM. This is similar to what the Linux decompressor does on, for example, ARM32. On ARM32, you have a decompressor, and the decompressor decompresses your kernel and passes it a device tree, so your kernel becomes independent of what SoC or board you run at. You can compile many different stuff into it and then pass it an external device description, and now you have an image that you can run on a wide array of systems. Barebox is the same in that regard, because you have this one Barebox binary, which is here shown in blue. Then you have a pre-boot loader in front of it that's board specific, that passes in the hardware description, that might load some firmware that is also board specific or SoC specific. And the Barebox proper part in blue just remains the same. For the IMX8M, you'll just have a couple of boards that are supported, mainly the main evaluation kits, not much boards based on it in tree yet. But for the IMX6, that's a couple of hundred boards that you can build just in one go with one configuration, and it all has the same Barebox proper binary in it, which is quite nice for development and also for test coverage. Well, and what else does this PBL do for the IMX8M? It passes a hardware description, as we have described. It does low-level NTSC RAM in it, and it loads early boot firmware. Let's show what that means exactly. So the pre-boot loader runs directly after the boot ROM ran, and it now needs to do some further SoC initialization, which is specific to how we will use the SoC. So it configures EL0 and 1 for non-secure operation. So you are probably familiar with privilege levels. So you have a privilege level for your user space applications and for your kernel. And this is to have isolation. You don't want your user space processes to be able to mess with the kernel, because then they could go via the kernel to actually mess with other user space processes. You don't want that. You want some isolation. And ARM Trust Zone extends that by even not trusting the kernel itself. So you can have multiple virtualized kernels and they shouldn't interfere with each other. And even the hypervisor could be compromised, but it shouldn't be able to siphon out secrets. And that's called non-secure operation. So you have a secure world that's separate from that. We will talk about this more, a bit more later. One more thing is to configure at what instruction set should be used for the lower levels. We will configure that as AR64, which is the 64-bit operation on ARM. We need to do some initialization because some registers don't have a defined value, but they are not yet used, so you need to define them before they are used later on. Or they had a defined value, but the boot ROM left them in a strange state. For example, the boot ROM, if it didn't, if not everything went to plan and it had a recovery boot, it leaves a cache on. So you need to just wholesale disable the caches, disable the MMU, so you know you are always in the state that you expect, regardless of what the boot ROM did. Then you need to initialize a clock tree for PBL usage. That's similar to what we have seen at boot ROM level, just that you probably access a bit more hardware in the PBL, so you will need to do some more configuration. We see an example to the right. You have these PLLs. After there, you have these muxes that define which of the inputs is taken as an output. Then you have dividers, which turn, for example, a 20 megahertz frequency in a 10 megahertz frequency. And then you have gates, which allow you to disable parts of the clock tree. All that needs to be configured, at least for these devices that we actually use. So here is an example of such a device, which is a serial port. So far we have been executing normal C code, but we didn't set up our C environment, which is basically the stack pointer. We didn't need to set that up ourselves. The boot ROM did for us. And we need to make sure that global variables work. So this is done in these two functions, relocate to current address and set up C. And from there on, you can use a normal C environment. We do that in the enable serial output function, the setup UART, this local function. It's at first, it turns on the clock, so the device can actually be communicated with. Then it does the pin muxing. So your SoC has a number of pads, and these pads can do different things. They can be used as a GPIO, they could be used as a I2C pin, or in our case, they can be used also for UART transmission. So you need to configure that. So the IP, which is intellectual property core, that device on the SoC knows how its signal should go out at what place. And then you do some device-specific configuration, like, for example, what baud rate do we want to do on our serial port. And then, now that we can use global variables, we save a global function pointer to the function that enables our output. Now we can write panic messages out if there is something wrong, and we have our clock tree set up, and now we can go about what we are meant to do, which is setting up the DRAM. So you have a PMIC that you need to configure. You have an SDRAM controller that you need to configure. We talked about this before and what that means in particular. And then you need to bootstrap your next stage of some boot media. The Barebox PBL has the assumption that where you will boot from is where you will boot the second stage from is the same place the first stage came from. So the boot ROM has already set up your SD card, for example. It did that dance at first where they exchanged what voltages are supported, it moved it to the correct state, it did pin moxing, it did clock setup for the host controller, the SD card is in the correct state, which is transmission, I think. So the SD card is there and it's usable. So you don't need to re-implement the driver from scratch if you want to use the exact same SD card. You can just jack up the frequency and issue directly these read commands and read off the SD card. This simplifies your driver codes a whole lot. So instead of some hundreds of lines, you can just have a dozen or so because you just need, well, to jack up the frequency, have a loop, copy off the data, and then boot that. And that's basically what Barebox is actually doing. And then you have this full Barebox image in DRAM. So far, we were in that limited size SRAM, and we had a header that told the boot ROM, just take this green part that you see here, which is the pre-boot loader. Now the pre-boot loader has copied the full image and jumps into it and in DRAM, and then it can continue. So now we are on DRAM, on the first CPU, and we could go and boot our Linux, right? But one thing we didn't talk about is what to do actually about the secondary CPU cores, who will take care of them. So enter ARM PSCI. So control of these secondary cores is highly SoC specific. And that was quite some source of headache for the kernel developers. So it was decided that for all ARM 64 platforms, the code for doing power management for the CPUs, CPU on, CPU off, CPU into suspend, CPU idle, and that stuff, that should live outside of the kernel. And that's what PCI does. PSCI, which stands for Power State Coordination Interface, is an abstract generic interface that allows Linux to call up and ask for stuff like turning on a CPU. This is nice because you can use the same PSCI driver in a kernel that runs under a hypervisor and a kernel that is the hypervisor and runs under KVM, because if it's called from the hypervisor, it goes one up to the secure monitor, and if it's called from the kernel, it goes one up to the hypervisor. So you now just have the same interface in both of them, and you have just one implementation in the secure monitor. And this secure monitor is called so because, well, it's a monitor, you can call to it, and it runs in an isolated secure world. The mechanism for facilitating that on ARM is called Trust Zone, which partitions your system into two domains. You have a secure and a non-secure world. Linux and your usual applications run in the non-secure world. That means they could be compromised, but they still couldn't access stuff that's only meant for the secure world, of course, if you set up your system correctly. And this non-secure world can still ask via a defined interface for resources out of the secure world. For example, for power management, clock and reset handling, and sometimes even hacks that the vendor couldn't get into mainline Linux, so they made it available in the Trust Zone monitor instead. One example for secure monitor is the reference implementation, which is a trusted firmware A for Cortex-A processors. What it actually does is a bit dependent on SoC, and it differs quite a lot, but what's the same everywhere is that it runs in the secure, i.e. trusted world. That's why it's called trusted firmware. On the IMX8M, it provides our secure monitor. It does PSCI for us. It configures the routing for our interrupt controller. and it loads and forwards secure monitor calls to the trusted execution environment, which is a separate operating system besides Linux that doesn't run in the non-secure world, but in the secure world instead. So why do you need that? You don't want compromised user space, kernel, hypervisor in the non-secure world to affect the secrets you have in the secure world. So you have sensitive data, for example, your TLS keys, you have disk encryption, and you don't want some buffer overflow in your web server to be able to siphon out these keys. You need to stream DRM-protected media. Well, your vendor wants to certify for streaming DRM-protected media. You want a trusted platform module, you want verified boot helpers. And all that you can do as trusted application in a secure user space. But these all need some operating system for coordination and so on. And so there is a standardized API for that, which is the GPT. And OPT is an open source implementation of that. And non-secure application like your web server can access these services. They have APIs for that, and this goes eventually over secure monitor calls to the secure monitor, which then passes it through to the trusted application. How that works like, we see to the upper right, we so far have been in exception level 3, which is where we start. Then you have secure exception level 1, which is our OPTI, for example. Then you have secure exception level 0, which is that secure user space where the trusted application run. And then we also have exception level 2 for hypervisor, exception level 1 for the operating system, and exception level 0 for the application. And what the X axis is supposed to be is the time axis. Well, back to our PBL. So we have a secure monitor we need to load. We want to use ARM Trusted Firmware as our secure monitor, and we need to load it in exception 3 before we go into exception 2. So Barebox does that by that you can link the TFA binary into your Barebox binary, and then Barebox copies the TFA into a specific location, and the TFA has a hard-coded address it returns to. Then Barebox jumps into the TFA. The TFA does its stuff, sets up the secure monitor, kicks off loading of OPTI, for example, and then it returns in exception level 2 into the full Barebox had loaded. Now you enter Barebox again. So you were in Barebox first stage, it loaded the TFA, and the TFA returned to the full Barebox you are, which is now in DRAM. And now you run in DRAM, and you can check, oh, I am now in exception level 2, not in exception level 3 anymore, so I have a secure monitor. So well, what's my job now? My job is to set up Barebox and to load a kernel. So how does it work? Barebox sees that it's in exception level 2, it enables the MMUs and caches, it verifies correctness of the Barebox image it will extract, it extracts the Barebox proper, we call it, which is that blue part. So we are still in the PBL now, but in DRAM, it extracts Barebox proper to the end of RAM, and then it jumps there and passes it to the device tree. So what you see here in the image, you have this DT, which is the device tree you pass, and this FW, which is the firmware in this case, ARM Trusted Firmware that you loaded. Well, device tree. We talked a bit some time about it, but we haven't really taken the time to really talk about it. And really talk about is these two slides. So why do you need a device tree? So not all hardware is discoverable. So on PCI or USB, you can just ask hardware, identify yourself, and the hardware actually answers and says, okay, I have this vendor ID, this product ID, and you can have a table and find out what kind of hardware it is. But you don't have that on a normal SoC interconnect. So you know there is a serial port, but you don't know at which address. You don't know the serial port, which clocks you need enabled for it, which interrupts does it use, and all that stuff. You don't know it. So you need someone to tell you that. It used to be that you have C codes that just hard code some structs that describe your hardware, and then that's passed to the driver. But this doesn't actually scale well when you have these big SoCs that have a lot of stuff, and then you have some of the stuff used and some not, and so on. So doing such stuff in C doesn't scale. The original open firmware specification specifies device trees, which is a way that you can describe a tree of devices. And it also specified how to have drivers. So you have a device and it comes with its description and with its driver. So just plug and play. Linux doesn't use that plug and play driver part, but it extended that hardware description part to great effect. And now that's how you add new platforms on ARM Linux. You write a device tree and you have drivers that use that device tree. There is an own specification now, and there are bindings that describe partially in machine readable format what is the contract between device tree authors and drivers. And well, it's a success. It's used by FreeBSD, Barebox, Ubuntu, TFA, Opti, Sapphire, and probably a lot more I don't know about. And it's not specific to ARM anymore. It's used on RISC-V, PowerPC, MIPS, even few x86, in addition to the original Spark where it originated. And yeah, it's mandatory for all new ARM Linux platforms. So you should know how it looks like if you want to delve deeper into that. Here's an example. So we talked about this doesn't scale because you have these different levels. And here's an example. So if Linux supports your SoC, it will probably have a device tree for that SoC, like this Flex SPI controller that we see here. And what that basically says, we have a device at this address. It has these two memory regions. One is called FSPI base, one is called FSPI mmap. It has these clocks, these interrupts with these names. And well, it's called an NXP, IMX8MM-FSPI. Okay, and then that's in every IMX8MM. Then you have a board, and that board uses that IP core, but of course had some board-specific configuration, like which pins is this controller actually connected at, and what's connected to these pins. So that's these pin control properties that we have here. This yellow stuff is references, so you have a node that describes which pins are used, and then you have a flash chip, and this flash chip has a max frequency of 80 megahertz, and then you have a driver. The driver says, hey, I support NXP, IMX8MM, FSPI. And then it can use a wide range of functions to know what is the memory range used, what are the interrupts used, and what's some SPI max frequency and such on, and so on. So the kernel uses that. Barebox uses that as well. And so we have passed this device tree to Barebox proper. So what's that about? So Barebox is basically a stripped down simplified kernel, you could say. It has most of its driver ported from Linux, and it also can probe from device tree. It has no interrupts, it just has cooperative multitasking, and it has Unix-like abstractions like you are used to from the kernel, like a virtual file system, a block layer, character devices you can interact with, and file descriptors and a shell. So you can basically say, okay, I want to copy from my hardware random number generator into my frame buffer. You can just say it like you would say in Linux. And of course you want to boot with it. So it has goodies for facilitating boot and development, which is the main reason we use it. It has redundant watchdog supervised boot sequences. It has shared state with the OS for variable exchange. It has primitives for hardware manipulation. It can fix up your device tree. For example, if you have some unportable stuff or you want to detect if you have a display connected or not and want the device tree to reflect that, you can do that in the bootloader and it can just on the fly modify the bootloader. It can verify a signed kernel image as part of your secure boot chain, and all of that is linked into a single binary. Well, you can now call the kernel image. There is nothing holding us back now. So what does it mean in particular? These points are copied from the or paraphrased from the official Linux documentation. So you need to mask interrupts. You don't enter the kernel with interrupts because the kernel wouldn't know how to deal with them. You should also, for example, turn off devices that do direct memory access, because if the kernel doesn't know that this part of memory just data is being shot there. You need to initialize the ARM standard timer. There is a header for the kernel as well that needs to be parsed by the bootloader. And there is an offset there that needs to be considered. Then it disables the MMUs, the data caches, and initializes the CPU control registers for either operation at EL2, if you want the kernel to be your hypervisor via KVM, or at EL1, if you want to start the kernel without hypervisor support. And the normal registers also need to be configured. For example, X0 holds the physical address of the device tree, so the kernel knows what device it's running on. And then jump to it. And that's it. You have now booted your Linux. What we haven't talked about in this talk is UEFI on ARM. That's also there. So a short bit about that. So basically, distros like their grub. They have all these workflows that use grub configs and tools that operate on them. And they want to support these popular SBCs like Raspberry Pi and so on. And so it feels natural to have grub actually run on your ARM system so you can use these mechanisms that you already have in place. But grub doesn't support all these different SoCs out there. Well, most bootloaders don't. You have a number of bootloaders, but well, it supports even less than other bootloaders for ARM. So why not take a bootloader that has many supported platforms, for example, U-Boot or even EtianoCore, and let it provide a minimal UEFI environment, and then compile grub as UEFI payload and run that on ARM. And then you can just ignore that you have all these ARM stuff, but you have your UEFI and you have your grub. But UEFI is quite complex, so you don't want to actually implement everything that UEFI specifies in your bootloader. There are the embedded and server-based boost requirements for that, which define subsets. What does that mean for you? It depends on who you are and what your needs are. So if you are an embedded vendor, you have this extra layer, which is a quite complex layer that you didn't need before. It solves problems, of course, but it's problems you can solve in other ways with less components. So it's actually an extra maintenance burden. Of course, it's my personal opinion. And then there are commercial SBCs, which are an attractive target for distros. And yeah, so just do UEFI. But the problem is it doesn't solve the really hard problems if you don't have dedicated flash for firmware, which is often the case. You have only the USD card or only that eMMC. And that means you can't have a universal OS image. You will always have the implementation of the UEFI on the same chip if you just have that one chip. On x86, this is different because you have a flash chip that comes with your motherboard that has the UEFI implementation on it. You can't do runtime variable storage because the specification for UEFI isn't flexible enough for that use case that you have a bootloader and a kernel that both need access to the same flash chip, and you don't need them to interfere with each other. And you can't actually update grub in a fail-safe manner without runtime variable storage. So that's a bit of a bummer. For ARM server, on the other hand, where you can have your extra flash chip and where you have a slightly, largely different needs, this can be quite attractive. You can use ACPI and extend it with device tree properties. And when you do that right and have all that support in place, you can boot your old long-term stable distribution that doesn't know anything about your hardware. And even on, you can boot it even on hardware that wasn't released yet, which is what you want as someone who uses ARM servers. As embedded vendor, it's usually the other side, other way around. You want to boot your new Linux on old hardware, not your old Linux on new hardware. Well, we've seen that image often on the right. Let's follow quite quickly our journey. So we had our boot ROM, which was masked into the chip. It executed our SPL, in our case, into SRAM. From SRAM, we set up the DRAM and loaded the secure monitor, which in turn loaded both our trusted execution environment in secure EL1 and our bootloader in EL2. Then our bootloader was responsible for starting the kernel, eventually either the Linux KVM as hypervisor or directly in EL1, and then the OS in non-secure EL1 executed the application and while and the trusted application run to the top here in secure EL0. If you are more familiar with the ARM terms, I have listed them here as well. I didn't use them for this presentation because they can be quite non-intuitive if you see them for the first time. So they start counting at the bootloader, at the boot ROM, BL1, BL2, BL3. That's okay, but then it goes in BL3.1, BL3.2, BL3.3. But it's shown here nevertheless, so you can put this into context. Well, if one thing in this, some particular thing in this boot chain caught your fancy, I collected some of the talks I had watched about that, and I can recommend. Well, that's it. Thank you for listening. It's a bit of a bummer that we couldn't be together in person in Brussels, but well, let's hope it will be better next year. And if you have any questions, I'm told there is a live segment right now, so I'm happy to hear them. Thank you.